at this side event that is co-organized by WWF UNCCD Rare and Crop Trust. My name is Gekasha. I am a UNCCD land hero and the founder president of Green Hope Foundation. And today we have with us some absolutely amazing speakers who will be talking about soil restoration and building drought resilience in light of climate change, which is actually a very, very timely topic, given just how much the triple planetary crisis is exacerbating the pressures on land. And moreover, we now have almost 8 billion mouths to feed. So the pressure on land has quite literally never been greater. With climate change, with biodiversity loss, with pollution, and with climate change amplifying all of that, it just goes to show how vulnerable our soils have become due to this exploitation of land. And it also shows us that with this degradation of the soil, we are slowly chipping away at human resilience and human lives and livelihoods. So that is why soil restoration for a more sustainable and a more healthy world is so critical, from our oxisols in the rainforest to our aerosols in the deserts to the gelisols of the tundra. All of our soil must be conserved and preserved. And today's panel, today's keynote will focus on practices, best practices, and moving towards sustainable soil restoration and preservation practices, how best we can harness this human potential of all of us to ensure that we protect our soils in different regions across the world, and how we can use these soil management practices to help mitigate climate change and ensure climate justice all across the world. It is really time for us to come together and ensure that soil is no longer a forgotten entity, no longer something that is just discussed as a side note. We need to put soil at the center of the agenda when we're talking about the triple planetary crisis, because without our soils, quite literally, we as human beings will not be able to be here. So on that note, it is my pleasure to invite to the stage Andrea Meza, Deputy Executive Director of the UNCCD, to give the keynote address. Floor is yours. First keynote address, and then I'll invite the panel.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the invitation. And it's really a pleasure to be sharing with the soil and land community. And it is great that we have more soil and land community in this COPs, and it's what we need. We're seeing that we are facing this triple planetary crisis. And sometimes we fight with this concept, even because we say, are we really including the land and soil as part of this crisis when we are describing everything that's going on? And we really need to give more political attention to this issue, because soil, it's the foundation of everything. If we want to have healthy economy, healthy societies, we need healthy soils. And this is why we are here as the UNCCD. We're calling ourselves the voice of land. It's the convention that it is trying to bring the attention on the importance of why it's critical to be doing land management, land conservation, and also addressing drought resilience. These two aspects are critical to guarantee food security, water security. And we know that the trend, it's not really on our side. Every decision that we're making around land, that we're losing ecosystems because of agriculture and not good practices in some cases, but also because of urban sprawl. And we are facing two big aspects here. And we need a lot of land use planning on one hand, for sure, and strengthen the capacities of the countries to do good land use planning. But we also need to transform our food systems. And in the morning, I was in another event in the morning with some familiar faces, and I really liked one of the phrases that you use: soil, a critical and concrete asset. And this is the other element. We depend, GDP, half of the GDP depends on these healthy ecosystems. And sometimes we don't do the links that we have with the economy. and the impacts that we have at that level as well. So for us, it's very encouraging to continue working with the different stakeholders to bring policy options, to bring the toolbox that we need to support the countries at all level and the producers and the water managers and the different sectors to do this transformation. The technologies are there. We really need to scale up these technologies. And we know that we need to invest also in land restoration and land management. And this is to do this, we need to bring the political attention first, and then to also demonstrate the economic case. And there are numbers, concrete numbers here. So it's very important to continue working with this whole of a government approach to really understand that we're talking about transforming our development model and to bring land as a center element in every decision that we're going to take in this development model. Because every piece of land and healthy soil we're losing, we're really losing the battle of climate change and biodiversity loss. So I think that it is about this, and that as UNCCD, we're here to continue supporting to use the decisions that you have there. There are critical decisions within our convention that it is already international law. You have it there. So it's more identify those decisions, support the countries, and let's make this transformation be a reality. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Andrea. Absolutely. And I'm really glad you spoke about how soil health is so related to drought resilience, how it causes water insecurity, food insecurity. It made me think of, I'm from Canada, and the western part of my country, British Columbia, is known for its plentiful rainfall. But these last few months, we've been experiencing some of the worst drought ever. And that's caused entire farming communities and cities to just run out of water. So this unpredictability caused by climate change is wreaking havoc on our land, on our soils, and in turn, it's causing food and water insecurity as well. So it's absolutely critical that, you know, once again, we see soil as an asset and we take measures to address all of the challenges that we currently face in relation to soil and land. So on that note, it is my pleasure to invite to the stage our panelists. And I will now take a seat and invite our eminent panelists to the stage who have really worked a lot throughout their lives on soil restoration, on drought resilience, and will be sharing with us their best practices in this regard. So if you could please come up to the stage when I call your name. We have Joao Campari, Global Lead, Food Practice of WWF International, Sharada Krishnan, Director of Programs of Crop Trust, Brett Jacks, President and CEO of RARE, Sol Ortiz-Garcia, Director for Policy and Climate Change, Ministry of Agriculture of Mexico, Gabriela Sotonilo, Head of Climate Change and Environmental Services of the Chilean National Forestry Institute. Welcome, everyone, and really delighted to have you all here today, and just really looking forward to hearing about your perspectives on the measures and actions that we need to take that can contribute to rebuilding soil health and building this drought resilience. So without any further ado, I'll give the floor to our first speaker, Joao Campari.
Yeah, delighted to be here, and what a great initiative. It's the second panel that I come in one day to talk about soil health and the measures that we need to take to improve the health. You know, about 2 billion hectares of lands are degraded or degrading in the world. That is about the size, approximately the size of South America, just to give you an order of magnitude of what we're talking about. I am an economist by training, and once I see an issue and a problem, I wear my economics lens. And this morning I said that soil is not something that you use and throw away. So soil is something that you need to nurture. it's from an economics and finance perspective, it's an asset class, right? There are streams of revenue. It's something that you need to manage well, not throw away. So it's on us, really, to bring soil health and restore degraded lands so that they can produce more food, more ecosystem services, or ideally both, right? We have at WWF, we prioritize soil health. And the reason why we do it, it's because about 25% of all life on Earth is beneath our feet. It's in the soils. So it's our job as a conservation organization to really care for this asset, for this source of life. Because without soil health, there is not going to be the health of our crops and the health of our people. So everything is connected. I have three key messages to share, if I may. The first one is that we aren't at all respecting soil, and that puts food security at risk, right? So 52% of all farmland on the planet is degraded, which adds up to the 2 billion hectares of degraded lands that I mentioned before. So if we continue with business as usual, over the next 25 years, could potentially reduce the lack of soil health, could reduce productivity of our crops by 12% and increase food prices by 30%, right? But that's not all. Less healthy soil doesn't just impact yields. It also reduces the nutrition density of crops. So we not only would have, if we continue with business as usual, with lower yields, but crops with lower nutritional density impacting nutrition for all of us. Now, the second message that I'd like to leave this in this room is that we can fix this. We can transform the way that we are treating soils, right? And the way to do it is by adopting nature-positive production systems. And we need to move away from a model that takes from nature into a model of farming with biodiversity. You know, biodiversity and food production should not compete with each other. One enables the other. In that regard, agroecology and regenerative farming practices are a way to do it, right? But what is regenerative agriculture? When I look at this slide here, the importance of crop diversity, let's just begin to think about this a little bit. 75% of our calories come from 12 plants and 5 animals. That's it. So regenerative should rely on many crops, on many species of foods, of the thousands of plants, and I don't know how many animals are there. I don't have the order of magnitude, but it's more than 12 and 5, right? So something is very wrong in the way that we're dealing with our own health and the soil health. How can we have diversity for producing 12 plants and 5 animals for 75% of our calories? So let's begin to think about this, you know, and the need to diversify our food systems for the sake of our health and soil's health. Now, and the third aspect that I, third message that I'd like to leave here is that farmers and ranchers, food producers, are our first environmental stewards, right? And as environmental stewards, they're also economic agents that respond to incentives and disincentives. So we need to begin to incentivize farmers and ranchers everywhere to adopt more and more nature-positive food production systems. How can we do that? Work with our governments to repurpose harmful subsidies that are harmful for nature today into nature-positive ones. There are $700 billion US dollars per year being financing food production, agriculture, but less than 5% is dedicated to any form of conservation. So something is very wrong, right? So we need more revenue streams, more finance, public and private, to go on the right way so that we can diversify our food system, we can restore degraded lands, and hopefully restore soil health so that they benefit people, climate, and nature together. Thank you.
Thank you, Joao. Absolutely. You know, we do need this nature positive, regenerative agriculture. Rebuilding our food systems. What really stood out to me was when you said we don't respect our soils. Very often we just refer to soil as dirt. And I think that's like one of the first indications that we are not looking at it as the asset that it is to our lives and livelihood. So thank you for highlighting that. With that, I shall invite our next speaker, Sharada Krishnan, Director of Programs, Crop Trust. You have the floor.
Thank you. This is working. Okay. And I have a few slides, and I think both Andrea and now Joao had talked about the importance of crop diversity. And I'm going to talk in the context of developing drought-resistant, drought-tolerant crops, and how you get to that resilience to adapt to climate change by using the diversity that is available in crops. And so so the calories come from about 70% of our calories come from very few crops. And this slide shows that 60% of our production, of food production, is based on three cereal crops: rice, maize, and wheat. And but then there are so many other crops that we don't tap, we have not tapped into the full potential of the diversity of crops. And they all have been locally used by local communities, but it has not been widely adopted in a global way. And some of the crops will always be local, but there we need to, because they have, it's not just the food security, we also need to look into nutrition security, because a lot of these crops, other than the main crops, have high nutrition content that we need to ensure that are reaching our population. So the way you can do it is, so you can tap into the diversity of all the different crops, but also within crops, we have lost diversity over the past through domestication. What has happened is we have been selecting plants for certain characteristics. And when you look at cultivation now, we are doing monoculture and not in a mixed cropping system. So in a monoculture, you're looking for that specific trait of high yield, and high yield that because of that, you have lost some of that important traits to drought tolerance or to pest or disease resistance. And if in monoculture, if something happens, your entire crop is going to be wiped out. So we had, the Crop Trust had a crop wild relative. So crop wild relatives are the distant cousins of our cultivated crops. And they have these genes that are either resilient genes that we need to transfer it into our cultivated crops. And so an example is eggplant. Eggplant, the three crops at the bottom are the wild relatives of eggplant. And tapping into those to bring some of the pest or disease resistance or drought tolerance into a cultivated crop is very important. And I'm gonna give a couple of examples of two crops that, so potato has been, many of you might have heard about the late blight of potato, the Irish famine that happened that caused the famine in Ireland through the potato, late blight of potato. So this is a new potato variety with the SIP, the International Potato Center in Peru, using three different potato species and crossing them to a cultivated potato to get disease resistance, late blight resistance. So you can control it with agrochemicals, but a lot of our farmers are smallholder farmers who do not have access to chemicals because of the cost of chemicals. So this new variety that has just been released in 2022, the methyled, SIP methyled potato variety, incorporate genes from three different wild relatives of potato. And so without using agrochemicals, now farmers in Peru are able to grow potato, and that is resistant to late blight. And another example is a newly released variety of wheat in collaboration with ICARDA, which is the International Center for Dryland Agriculture, based in Morocco and in Lebanon. The Morocco, this was Jabal wheat, has just been released, and it's going to be, the seeds are going to be increased for release, wider release to farmers in the region. And this is very highly resistant, drought tolerant. And this was developed using a wild species of wheat from Syria, which was incorporated into our durum wheat, cultivated wheat. And so many of this, we talked about farmers. We need to ensure that it is a participatory way of selecting varieties, because if the farmers are not involved in the selection of these varieties, then there is going to be lesser adoption. So this one from 2017 to 2021, field trials were done in Morocco with the farmers, and that, and the period was also great when the drought happened and a lot of the other varieties failed. This was the only variety that survived the drought. And so the farmers saw it firsthand, and now the farmers have adopted it. And this has now been registered by the Ministry of Agriculture in Morocco for utilization by farmers. And then finally, to end the talk, you know, there are many challenges ahead of us. But I mean, there is, by using the crop diversity, we have seen examples of utilizing crop diversity to build resilient varieties that can be disease or drought tolerant. So this is just an example through a crop wild relative project, which happened. This was funded by the government of Norway between 2011 to 2021. And through that project, we had over 100 partners that worked on it, where we collected these crop wild relatives of 29 crops all over the world and have safeguarded them both in Svalbard and the Millennium Seed Bank in at Kew, the UK. And from that project, these are some of the different crops where we have developed resilient varieties for release to farmers. So it is possible. So there is hope, but we need to act fast before that crop diversity is lost. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharda, for speaking about the importance of crop diversity and highlighting how it does actually work and how it's so critical to rebuilding our soil health and building drought resilience. So thank you once again. I shall now invite our next panelist, Brett Jacks, President and CEO of WARE. You have the floor.
Thank you so much. I'm going to cheat because I'm the least amazing of the panelists. So I just want to make sure I can see what I'm supposed to be talking about. So we talk a lot about adoption. We talk a lot about the need, the solutions and technologies. And often the challenge is, how does that adoption actually take place? Just because we know what the answer is doesn't necessarily mean it gets utilized. And so I want to tell you a quick story about a very early project that RARE has been working on, designed to help accelerate adoption of really promising climate smart agricultural practices. Quick backdrop, RARE is a US NGO, and we have a Center for Behavior and the Environment. We've done a lot of work with WWF, and that partnership is growing on food waste in China and a couple of other really exciting things related potentially to plant-rich diets in Europe. But we're going to go to Colombia. So why does Colombia matter? Everybody here already knows this. Second most biologically diverse country in the entire world. Ultimately, all I want you to look at is that number 16%. Because of the conflict in Colombia, there are less than 16% of farmers have had any technical assistance in generations, literally generations, no agricultural extension because they couldn't provide it. That's a real challenge if you're going to try to influence how people farm, and if you're going to build trust between extensionists and farmers, if they never meet, very difficult. So what did we do? Next slide. The goal here, we created a program called Lands for Life. I love the way we're talking about soil, not dirt. lands make life. We had four major goals. We want to improve the livelihoods of smallholder farmers. We want to improve soil health. And along the way, we want to make sure that the outcome is increased soil organic compounds, increased soil carbon. We should be able to measure that. In California, in the United States, if you cross the Golden Gate Bridge from San Francisco to Marin, there are Marin farmers who are measuring their soil organic compounds, and they will tell you there's a direct proportion between the soil organic compound in the plot, the flavor of the tomatoes, and their market value. And it's a 1-to-1-to-1 relationship. If we enrich the soil, we get a healthier planet and we get more productive diets and farmers who are better off, conceptually at least. Obviously, this, as a biodiversity organization, this is also really about globally the half a billion smallholder farmers, not just their plight, but the opportunity to rescue soils. So here's what we did. We started off with a behavior-centered design. Can you go to the next slide? Many of you have the same lists. This is what climate smart agriculture looks like. So just going through it, enriching the soil with compost. Only 6% of the farmers that we were working with were composting when this program began, using their own natural byproducts and ingredients to enrich their soil. Only 6%, because the only technical assistance they had had for 40 years in some cases was from large industrial petrochemical and fertilizer suppliers. That's the only advice they got. Literally no local composting. Implementing fertilization plans, expanding cover crops, beginning to use their own data, agroclimatic data, setting up their own capability to predict and plan landscape management, and then integrated pest control, similar to what other panelists have already described. Here are quick results of just a very early trial leveraging behavior change techniques. So starting in 2021, we segmented the entire target audience by focus groups and surveys to understand which farmers were going to be most open to cooperating. Then mid-resistance farmers were those who were going to need some proof. And then finally, the laggards or the high-resistance farmers we put off for the future. Because our strategy, informed by social psychology, neuroscience, evolutionary biology, is once you can establish social proof, you can leverage social pressure. I'm oversimplifying decades of research, and obviously for everyone in this room, years of extension experience, but it's critically important that you get social proof to social pressure if you're going to boost adoption. So that was the strategy up front. We pre-registered our hypothesis, wrote an article about our intentions so that we could then hold ourselves accountable to the outcomes. So let's jump to the next slide. Here's what actually happened. Just over the course of a year, just follow the green color. In terms of enriching soil with compost, we started with, of the farmers in this target group, 6% were composting before the program. 97% were composting 12 months later. From 52% implementing cover crops to 93%. From zero farmers using agroclimatic data to 61%. These are really significant behavior changes. And the point isn't to tell you we have the solution. The point is to tell you that there is a really important set of strategies from behavioral science that can be leveraged by extensionists worldwide with just a little bit of training. Next slide. So in short, here's what we envision scaling looking like. And that is you start off with social diffusion from social proof to social pressure. Based on new expectations. We all know that once you see someone else change, you're more likely to change. Once you think other people expect you to change, you're more likely to change. Once you think other people are starting to change quickly, you are more likely to not even think about it, but change. We all think we're rugged individualists, immune to social pressure. We are all still in high school. We are lemmings with hands. That's the truth. That's the dirty little secret about humanity. And if we can understand how to change ourselves, we will be much more effective as practitioners. And that's the goal here. So one, social diffusion. Two, a lot of training by those who have just done it. The same way we all learned how to make pancakes or how to make rice from our parents, from our sisters, from our mothers, from our friends. Farmers learn how to farm from other farmers, not the guy that shows up in the logoed shirt, okay? And then finally, technology. So we're having a series of, we've built this new technology specifically for these farmers, just using WhatsApp. This week, Meta announced a new product called WhatsApp Communities, and we're discussing what it would look like to modify and create communities through WhatsApp that will basically become a 24/7 extension service that's already off, that's just off the shelf. We think this is hugely promising. We do not need to be building our own technologies for every crop, for every farmer. Let's pull it off the shelf and focus on behavior change. That's the promise. We are the least experienced group here, but we do have the beginner's mindset set and the advantage of just getting started. So thank you very much. Cheers.
Thank you very much, Brett, for speaking about the work and just how important behavior change is in this regard and how it is working, and in the statistics, the change in statistics after the program. It's just amazing to see that this does work, and this does not only, it doesn't even, like, it's not only benefiting the human beings, but it benefits the land as well. So thank you very much for sharing that with us. Our next speaker is Sol Ortiz Garcia from the Ministry of Agriculture of Mexico. You have the floor.
Thank you very much. And thank you also for the invitation. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here. Let me start by sharing what is the status of soils in Mexico. As previous speakers have mentioned, we are in a problem as well, saying that around 60% of our soils are degraded, they have different levels of degradation. And we also are in dire straits because we have this very dry, 70% of our country has dry conditions. So that doesn't help that much for soils. But what we decided to do not too long ago, and this according to instructions of our minister, Dr. Victor Villalobos, is to work in a national strategy for soils in sustainable agriculture. So this is called the NASAS. And it has been a process that it took us almost 2 years because the pandemic was not collaborating too much to build this strategy, but it's done now. And luckily for us, Dr. Villalobos didn't say, well, once we have the strategy, we start working. No, we have been working with soils for a while. And I want to share a little bit how the first, how the strategy was built, and now what are the how is this structure, and some examples of what have been doing in the framework of this national strategy for soils national strategy for sustainable agriculture. So we start putting together an advisor group of different institutions, and this is to start with because we know that it's very hard to come up with a law on soils. We know that we need a law for the whole country on soils, not just agricultural soils, but we don't want to wait too long. So we started putting this strategy for agricultural and livestock soils, the ones that we are under, the ones that we have under the Ministry of Agriculture. This group of experts who have been working with soils for a long time and have a very close relationship with farmers come up, help us to develop this strategy. The strategy is looking to improve and enhance the governance of soils in Mexico. It has seven strategic axes. The first is in relation to soil conservation. What we are doing fine in some of our soils, we have to keep doing it and keep doing it right. So we have this first strategy, which aims to keep soils fertile. and maintain soils biodiversity. And this is in relation to good practices and sustainable soil management. The second part of the strategy is soil restoration, because we recognize that there are many of our soils need to be restored. Sorry for my English. Restored. Thank you very much. And then we have this, the third strategic axis is about monitoring, because we know we have to learn to measure how soils are going, how our strategy is being applied, where we need to do what. And this is something that we also have been working along with the Global Soil Partnership, because we know that we have to present how the status of soils in Mexico are. So we, in this strategic axis, we have been working to produce our map of potential soil carbon, and also to soil carbon and soils with salinity problems and all this. So we are recognizing where are the problems of our soils in a bigger scale than is needed, but this is how we working. Also, because we need to monitor to see what is working and what is not working. The fourth strategy is very important and is awareness of the importance of soils. And as people had said it before, we need to recognize that soils are really the center for food security. So, and the next strategy is about research and how can we improve the soils, what is working where, because there's no one single recipe for all the soils in Mexico, I bet in any other country. And how do we transfer this knowledge to farmers? And finally, we have the last strategy is to enforce the regulation for having better soils. And so this is the main components of this strategy. And some of the examples that we have been working with is, I'm going to mention two of the important partnerships that we have. One is with CIMIT, the International Center for Improvement of Maize and Wheat. And they have been enhancing and going with farmers with these hubs that they have and showing how farmers have to do better soil management practices. And we luckily have the first results for many years of work in minimal tillage agriculture. And this has increased productivity in most of the places that have been done. And these kind of soil practices also helps to maintain water, humidity, and reduce erosion, soil erosion. So this is one of the examples. The other example that we are starting to work with is in the framework of the FAO. This program is called Soil Doctors, and it's a program that we started with the National University of Mexico and the Ministry of Agriculture, working with soils scientists and soil technicians. And we go with farmers. We identified what we call champion farmers that other farmers follow. And we do some capacity building about soils, how to make samples, for example, how to know your soil, which are the importance of soil carbon, the importance of practices. And this is at the land level. It's not for everybody, but you go to these places, identify the people, and then you learn which ones want to be soil doctors. And then after these capacity building activities, you certify them with the FAO and the UNAM certification. And that's how you start this escalating of the knowledge about soils farmer to farmer, which I agree that is how you work better if farmers share with farmers how to manage better their soils. So these are some of the examples. And just to close this short participation, I want to mention that we have this systemic approach. We have this ENASAS, our National Strategy for the Soil Conservation and Sustainable Agriculture. And this is going along with another strategy that is related to the conservation of genetic resources for food and agriculture. And this comes to the idea of having this diversity. Mexico is also a very diverse country, and we are the center of origin of more than 150 edible species, including very important ones like maize. And then we have this program for how to link this diversity of crops with the diversity we have in soils and the diversity of production systems. And that's how we're doing this systemic approach, also with another group of organisms that are very important, which are pollinators. And maybe we don't see the direct link with soils and pollinators, but many important pollinators have part of their life cycles in the soil. So this is another way to get awareness of the importance of having healthy soils. So we are taking soils very seriously in Mexico, not just in terms of their health, but also in their terms of conservation, restoration, and putting in the center the farmers, particularly women. So thank you.
That's wonderful to hear. Thank you so much, Sol. And thank you for sharing just how multi-pronged the strategy is, and particularly how, you know, everything addressing it from biodiversity conservation to awareness to building drought resilience and restoring soil health. And I really liked how you said one size it doesn't fit all. So you need very specific solutions, even within the country context. So thank you for highlighting that. I shall now invite our next speaker, Gabriela Soto Nilo of the Chilean National Forestry Institute. You have the floor.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm going to talk. I don't want to sit and spend like 40 hours in a plane yesterday. I don't want to be sitting anymore. Thank you for the invitation. For Chile, the degradation of soils is a very huge topic. It's not only the degradation, also desertification. We are more and more changing to like the Desierto de Atacama. It's very, very like getting close to the other part of the country, then is really an issue for us. And where I'm from, the National Corporation of Forest, and we are the red focal point, and also we are the UNCCD focal point. For that reason, for us, degradation, desertification are really linked to the forest. It's impossible for us to try it in different way. In that, we have been working since 2014 in our national red strategy that includes UNCCC and UNCCD too. And we are working in that insurance that we are already gonna have to work in a combined way, okay? The strategy has different measures, and one of the strong characteristic of this strategy that we developed the strategy with the community. We had a huge participatory process. It was 1 year for participatory process. Everybody in the country, not everybody, but the most important stakeholders were participating in the 15 region of Chile. And also we have an important topic for that. Years it was 2017, I guess, but gender topic, it wasn't a really important topic. We have to recognize that, guys. But in the strategy, we include at least 30% of participation of women. And that for us is very, very important. If women are very linked to the earth and also to the forest. For that reason, for us, it was very important to include them. And also we include the indigenous people. We have a different participation process for them. Then we have more, lot of like 4,000 persons that we participate in this process. The basis of the different measures that we have is really strong for us. That is one of the things that we want to commit, because you talk about that. And if we don't have the community involved from the basis, it is impossible to go forward for us, at least. For that reason, we have different measures too, and we need to get I'm sorry, I lost my track of idea. We are working together with other sectors too. And for the forest sector, we have different commitments with our NDC. The NDC of the country is really based on forest. We have a very high metas. I forgot the word in English. Goals. Sorry. We have very high goals. We have 200,000 of hectares to new forest to get in. And also we have to develop like forest, sustainable forest management to in 200,000 to of, but that is in only native forest. Okay. Also we have a very high goal to include 1 million of hectares in process of landscape restoration too. For that reason, and all that measures, soil is of course a huge part. If we don't have a good soil, it is impossible to get forest, new forest or restorate the forest. For that reason, it is really important. In all the measures, we include some measures too, to get sure if the soil that we are working on the territory, it is in the correct way. We developed also in 2016, I guess. Yeah, 2016, our national neutral and the report of national degradation neutrality for the convention. And 2011, we updated with different kind of technologies, and we have not so good news. The level of desertification in Chile is really increasing. More than 17% of our country is in high level of risk of the desertification, and at least 6% is in high risk of desertification. It's 23% of high or major leap or desertification, which is very important. 26% of our territory is a lot. For that reason, we have to work together and try to fight against this issue. And we are with the strategy, with the red strategy, we already had a finance from the GCF. We are working with them in different kind of measures like forestation, restoration of forest, but also including, of course, restoration and restoration of soils too. For that reason, for us, it was very important to show you that it is impossible for us at least to separate forest of soil. We think that we have to work together to increase to get our goals in our NDC too, but also we really need, and I don't know who talked in at the beginning, we really need a policy maker to encourage this topic in all in the decision level, because we are technical, so we try to work and try to emphasize the importance of this, but if we don't have the politicians and the decision makers really encouraging this topic, it for us it's impossible to achieve our different goals. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Gabriela, for speaking about, you know, what I really like. You said that the community has to be involved, like right from the beginning. And at the beginning, you talked about the involvement and inclusion of women and indigenous peoples. And that is so, so crucial for everything, really, particularly when we're dealing with addressing soil health, drought resilience, and rebuilding our resilience to climate change. So thank you once again. So we are almost out of time. So in the interest of time, I would just like to pose one last question to our panel, and you can use this time to use it as your concluding remarks. So in 1 to 2 minutes, I would love to hear from you. What do you expect out of COP27, and how do you think you can best get soil health and drought resilience on the agenda? So we shall go in reverse order. So Gabriela, if you would like to start.
I'm going to repeat the thing that I just told you guys. I think we have to, encourage our authorities, the decision makers, to push this topic, because otherwise, if don't have the politic, how do you say, respaldo? The political support, it is impossible. Really, it's impossible. I think as a technical, we have to try to push in a high level this.
Thank you very much. You have the mic.
Yeah, thank you. I think I would like a lot to see from this COP that soils are recognized as a very important player for climate change, not just in terms of what can we do with sustainable soil practices in terms of adaptation, but also that soils can help us to capture carbon, and that farmers could be included in the equation. Farmers that are trying to transit to a better way to manage soils have to be recognized, and we have to go to the place where we can measure the carbon that they are capturing with these practices and recognize their efforts and incentivize them. I think that's something that I would like to start seeing from this COP. Thank you.
Thank you, Saul. Right.
So if I could wave my magic COP wand, I would say, moving forward in the world, after this next week, for every economist that there is in this whole space, there is also a social psychologist and maybe a behavioral economist, just to keep them honest, just to keep them in check. Because I'm just really joking with you, Joelle. Humans are not homo economicus, right? We are human beings. We are not terribly logical. If we're going to make change, we're going to have to really work harder at how we make change. Fortunately, the UNFCCC in their latest report past summer had a whole section on the significance of behavior change, in part authored by one of our board members, Dr. Elka Weber at Princeton. So for the first time, we're starting to see this prioritization of behavior change within something as large as the COP. And I think if we were to plant one seed, it would be that.
Thank you, Brett. Sharada?
Yes. So the Global Crop Diversity Trust, we are a funding organization, and we fund gene banks that conserve crop diversity in perpetuity. And for the way we do it is through our endowment fund. And in order to protect all the crops and all the gene banks and the crops that they're protecting, conserving in those gene banks, we need to raise our endowment fund so we can take 4% of the endowment fund to give to the gene banks for conservation in perpetuity. And so what I would like to see is all governments committing to support the Crop Trust Endowment Fund and put money into the fund so they can, that all the crops around the world can be conserved in perpetuity. And I'm just thrilled to say that New Zealand government did allocate part of their climate fund specifically to conserve the crops in the South Pacific region. So there are mechanisms to do that, and we want all the governments to commit.
Thank you, Sharada. Shua?
Thank you. Brent, you scared me for a while here. I thought you were going to say for every economist in this COP, we would need a lawyer. And then when you began about behavioral change, that was a great one. So thanks. For WWF, we launched a manifesto in which we call for 5 actions. But embedded in these 5 actions, first, we need more action and less talk. We need to move from commitments to action. That's the one thing we repeat this in every COP. And guess what? There is not enough action to match the commitments. But mostly what we need to see in this COP is that food systems transformation are integrated into everything, into every document that comes out of this COP, especially the Coronavia. we cannot afford to let Coronivia fall short on food systems transformation, right? And there is a specific role for soil, because soil health is not only about agriculture, it's about human health as well and planetary health. So let's push for the systemic change that we need to see. And, you know, for countries, our countries, let's advocate for countries to begin to embed food systems transformation as part of their NDCs. And let's push for Coronivia to embed it as well. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you, Joe. And thank you to all of our panelists. This has been such an amazing discussion. And I feel that it really has shown us why we need to renew our focus on the urgent need for soil restoration, especially in the context of all of our unpredictable weather patterns caused by climate change and with increasing drought severity all across the world. So thank you once again. And with that, I shall give the floor to Kelly Witkowski of the IICA to close the session.
Thank you. I'll just stay right here. You know, I think we all know, or I won't. It was a sign. I think we all know that the main show here is really, you know, the negotiations, which can be quite slow and quite frankly painful, especially Coronivia has been slow this time. And so I've had a little extra time to be attending all these amazing side events and really listening to these incredible people that are so dedicated and have, you know, really great ideas that are working. And it makes me kind of want to run away and roll up my sleeves and start working, because the risks are growing. And we know that collective action focusing on soil health with people at its core is really the catalyst for change that we need now. There is no more waiting for tomorrow. And there's no question we need to do this. Listening to the behavioral change models of RARE, the work to utilize crop wild relatives and genetic diversity of the Crop Trust, efforts to move global policy through the UNCCD, move forward with a food systems agenda from WWF, Mexico's efforts to drive soil policy and map and monitor soil carbon and eventually get it into their NDC, and the efforts to conserve forests in Chile through their National Red Strategy. I mean, there's really amazing things going on, and it's agriculture and even more so soils are a great connector. I mean, there's a topic here, there's an agenda for everyone. And you know, there's the water community, the soil community, the biodiversity community. They can all come together around this issue: health, ag, nutrition, forestry, food security, the productivists and the conservationists. I mean, they all need soil. And I think there's a lot of polarization that goes on and people thinking that they have the solution. And for me, that's just really not true. I mean, we really need all the possible solutions and we need everybody at the table to make this happen. And so this panel raised a lot of questions for me about how do we raise this agenda on the issue. We hear that the technical folks are working and they really need the decision makers, the higher level decision makers, to put this higher on the agenda. How can we access more patient capital that allows us to make the change over the timeframes that soils can be improved? How can we better support our farmers? What are the effective co-innovation models? And how do we work together rather than in parallel as all these different institutions that have parts of the wider systemic change that we all need? And so how do we put these pieces together into an integrated strategy that really allows for the transformation that we need? And how do we think bigger? I think that's where the private sector comes in, because they're not as budget limited as many of the nonprofits and governments are. So they can think bigger. So how do we bring them to the table to help make sure that we have the scale and pace of transformation that we need? And how do we co-construct in a way that's flexible for all? How do we find the commonalities in the agenda? How do we change the language a little bit that we use to make everybody feel included? And how do we use that to drive the passion, you know, that I really feel here, and the excitement that everybody has for what they're doing, to make sure that we're moving forward in a way that has the impact that we're all looking for. So thanks very much to everyone. And yes, we have a question. So real quick, after this, we have a panel with USAID and IFPRI about a new project that's being launched to implement the NDCs in agriculture. in Latin America and the Caribbean. And at 7 o'clock, you're all cordially invited to a reception sponsored by the Protein Pact here at the Pavilion with Dr. Ratan Lal, one of the world's leading soil scientists, will give words at the beginning. That's why you're the boss, Loy. Do we have time for one question?
Sure.
If you guys don't mind. Okay.
Thank you. I will take the chance that we are here with a great group. I work for a company that uses or works on the voluntary carbon market crediting system to send funds for cattle raising or nature-based solutions in South America, the southern part of South America. But we are also working in Colombia, in Chile, and Argentina, and Paraguay, etc. I think I agree and I add to everything you said. And right now, what we are experiencing, going to the field, we are very much on the field, working on the field with WWF in Paraguay, and when we need to implement the projects for example, cattle raising rotation, we are on the need of extra funding. Only the market doesn't support everything you need. Both for the crediting and getting through the crediting cycle, but also for help the farmers to change their behavior, or because it's very much more work intensive to get this rotational system. So and increase, what we do is increase soil carbon. Then we work in red projects as well. But what I think is it's a real challenge right now to get extra funding or get together in co-funding, because if not, it will be difficult in this case for us to push the whole projects that we are and we are dealing, we are aiming to do 10 million tons in the next per year in the next 20 years. So that's a nice aspect. I work with many of the organizations and myself in WWFs, and I know now I'm lucky to be in the field working with such a great opportunity, but it's still very difficult to move forward and implement. We work also in blue carbon in Mexico. I was on the sclerophyllo forest in Chile, trying to get a red project there. You did a very good thing implementing fire prevention measures 1 or 2 months ago. So that was additionality in soil carbon is something that we need to work on. And thank you very much. I don't take much more time. Thanks.
Thank you to everyone.
Thank you.